Hello, this is Paul with Reloading123, and you're going to find this going to be a little bit different video than I've done for you in the past. I'm in my office. I've got my Rottweiler here sleeping at my feet, and this is going to be the intro to a video on head spacing, arguably the most important subject when it comes to accuracy and rifle reloads. But regardless of rifle, pistol, it's a very important subject that you grasp. And so I spent probably about 6 minutes or so going over the fundamentals. Now, the reason why this video is going to be a little bit different is because I actually took a business trip last week to Cancun, Mexico, the Yucatan Peninsula, and I recorded the video over breakfast, and the window was open in the back, and the birds were chirping, and so and then the waves were, you know, you could hear the surf in the background, so it's going to be a little bit different kind of a video. But one thing you're going to find is that I prepared sketches of a chamber and a cartridge in advance, and prepared my notes on the airplane and did the video there. So I did the sketches because I didn't want to have any copyright infringement. So hopefully you enjoy it. Hopefully you'll understand exactly what this space is all about and how you can manipulate it to a degree to make the most out of your rifle. Hello, this is Paul with Reloading123, and you might find this kind of interesting, but I'm actually going to do a video and try to discuss headspace. This is an important topic that I want to talk to you about before we dive into rifle reloading. It's probably the single most important topic that you need to understand when reloading rifles. It's one of the main reasons why we reload four rifle calibers for accuracy. And you may hear some interesting noises here in the background, some crazy birds and whatnot, because I am on the Yucatan Peninsula this week in Cancun, Mexico. So hopefully you're relaxed by the sound of birds and breeze and surf in the background. But I'm just, I thought that I could pull this off and share a video with you as I kind of prepared it on the plane. So you're going to see some kind of drawings and some sketches from me simply because I wanted to avoid any kind of copyright issues. So let's dive right into it, or else this is going to get long. So headspace, really the definition, or probably the best definition of headspace, is measured from the part of the chamber that stops the forward motion. So on a and I'll show you what that looks like, but let's just kind of finish the definition. That could stop the forward motion to the face of the closed bolt. So in this situation, this red line is going to be the closed bolt face, and this particular cartridge is head spacing up here on the shoulder, what we would call kind of an imaginary datum line. Now, I did kind of a crude drawings of these. Let's see if I can maybe help you here a little bit. So on a Magnum, what that's going to mean, it's going to be the full bolt face to the front of the belt. You know, on a rimmed cartridge, it's going to be the bolt face to the front of the rim where it hits the steel part of your barrel. On a pistol round, where it actually head spaces on the mouth right here, that's going to be where the actual head space dimension is. On a non-belted Magnum, which basically you saw in that picture that I drew for you, it's the bolt face to this invisible datum line on the shoulder, which is really what you're seeing here. So that's the definition of headspace, and it's an this dimension is absolutely critical to your rifle. Now, for factory loads and whatever else, it doesn't. They have to give you kind of a generic number based on some SAMI recommendations, because they got the cartridge has to chamber in every type of gun. But we're talking about accuracy, and we're talking about actually making a cartridge that's specific to your rifle. So too much headspace would equate to poor accuracy, and also some other problems like split necks and whatnot. And then too little headspace, it may not chamber at all. So, you know, as we're talking about this, you know, what happens when the firing process is the firing pin comes out of this bolt face, right, and it hits the primer. When it does that, essentially it pushes this cartridge forward, and what you'll see here is that it expands, so this is going to go completely forward. It's also, so it's going to push it up against this shoulder here, right? Then what it's going to do is it's going to create what we would call excess headspace to a degree, because it's going to leave a fairly sizable gap between the face of the bolt and the back of the cartridge. So really what it's doing is pushing this thing forward, like I'm doing, and hitting this shoulder, and then it's going to expand in all directions, right? And when it does that, it stretches the brass out. The brass is soft for this reason. It expands the neck completely, and then it's also going to expand backwards. So you're going to see it this way as well. So the brass expands in all directions to a degree to seal the chamber, and to basically when the cartridge fires. Okay. This expansion happens, and it's really actually a necessary part of the process. That's the reason why we have a brass case, and part of the reason why non-brass steel cases can be a little bit dirtier, because they can bypass some air, some spent gas backwards. And you know, you have expansion areas here in the neck, because that's holding the bullet, and it has to release the bullet, and then the expansion areas here. Okay, and the reason this thing is expanding in both directions, this is the reason why we have to trim the edge of this. We're going to talk about trim in another video, but you're gonna see that the case lengthens, and that's the reason for that. Make sense? So let's take a look at the accuracy component. This is a pretty crude drawing that I did on the airplane, but you're going to see that this is a theoretical, you know, perfect world. You know, and you can see I kind of drew like a little gap all the way around this cartridge. But in reality, and this is exaggerated, but what happens is for a factory load, is it goes into your chamber, and it actually ends up kind of like it sits on its side. And this, like I said, again, super exaggerated, but if you think about it, it's going to have all this room on top. Makes sense, right? And then the bullet, as you'll see in this picture, is not aligned with the barrel. If this is the center axis of the barrel, the bullet is slightly off center because of the way the rifle is sitting in the chamber. So we want to maximize accuracy by aligning this bullet with the center axis of the bore. Also, we want to maximize our brass life and reduce the amount of times it has to expand and then contract when you're resizing it, right? Making sense? And we're going to do that by a couple of different means. And we're going to talk about how we can control, you know, that headspace. And you can see I'm kind of giving you pages with my notes, but you know, it's all good, right? So every chamber being slightly different in size, when we're doing this for a specific rifle. We need to do it for, if you have two 270s, you have a set of brass for one and a set of brass for another. If you want to maximize accuracy, then maximize brass life, and for a specific gun. Otherwise, you know, you don't even have to worry about this. A fire case is essentially a mold of your chamber. So if you think about that, you take a brand new cartridge, you fire it, this thing expands, filling this chamber. It cools ever so slightly on the extraction, and that's how you're able to get the thing out of there. But really, the cartridge is your mold. A fired cartridge is a mold of your specific chamber. So that's probably the most important thing to think of, because that's what we're going to kind of tune this thing around. So you want to minimize the headspace by not full length resizing. So I've showed you in like the pistol video how you run the brass up into the die, and then you cam over the bottom, if you remember all that stuff. Well, this in this situation, you're going to run this into the die, but you're not going to run it all the way. You're going to run it only part of the way, and thus it only pushes this shoulder back just ever so slightly, so the gun will still chamber, it'll be aligned, and the next time you fire it, it doesn't stretch the brass too much. So you can really do this by just resizing the neck. And you've heard of neck sizing. So in some rifle cases, you can just neck size, which will just focus on this area. And then in other there's an advantage to that, actually. So when you neck size, it's the case is very well fit to the chamber. All you're doing is adjusting the neck down to fit the bullet. When the cartridge goes in the chamber, it's almost perfectly aligned. The only challenge with neck sizing is the fact that after so many times that you neck size, the cartridge will be too tight. It loses its malleability, or loses its flexibility, or how soft it is, and it kind of work hardens. And it's actually going to make it so you actually, at some point, you have to full length resize to get it back to its original diameter. And then you can go back to neck sizing again. And in between, you'll probably want to anneal. And that's going to be a future video, but just remember the word annealing. So then you can actually, the next option is a high-tech term called bump sizing. And that's basically when you run the piece of brass up into the die, but you just don't run it all the way. So what it really does is it resizes the neck, and it pushes the shoulder back just a hair, and it pushes the body in just a hair, maybe 2 or 3 thousandths of an inch maximum. And you're going to ask me next, how the heck do I measure that? And I'll tell you how that works. So what's going to do is it's going to make it so you can easily chamber the round, and that you'll never actually need a full length size, because you're actually doing a very subtle full length sizing every single time. Both options had, just the neck sizing and the bump sizing offer great accuracy, and they both offer a great case life, but the consistency of bump sizing, which I would encourage you to do, is more important to me than just neck sizing alone. But you're going to see a lot of shooters just neck sizing cartridges and managing their brass. So you need a special tool, and I would encourage you to look at the RCBS Headspace gauge, which is a tool that you connect to your calipers, and you basically measure a point from here, what we call the headspace, to here. Well, it's not really a headspace officially, but what it does is it measures what your original, you take your original round and you measure it, and then you resize it, and then you measure the result of the resizing, and all you really want to do is push that back, 0.002 to 0.003 of an inch, so 2 or 3 thousandths. And then that would actually give you a cartridge that fits the chamber very tightly. You don't have the issues with a chambering around that you will with neck sizing. Makes some sense? My last slide. So basically, I want to talk to you a little bit about the limitations. So really, you don't want to mess with neck sizing. When you're dealing with auto-loading rifles, you want to just full-length size every time. And the reason we've already talked about is you want to make sure that this particular cartridge goes into the chamber flawlessly every time. And to do that, you have to err on the side of caution. So it's really not for an auto-loading rifle. I would say even lever-action rifles could be a little bit challenging. I had a situation a long time ago with my Thompson Contender where it's a break action, and I thought the action had closed all the way. I heard the distinctive click, but it really had not. And although I was getting great accuracy with, those days I wasn't bump sizing, I was just neck sizing. But it actually opened and shot the round right back into my shooting glasses. So I would caution you that it's just really not for certain cartridges. And then, some cartridges, like we talked about over here, that that Headspace on the Magnum case, you really have less benefit because when you're resizing this case, you're really resizing the neck and the body. There's some advantage of adjusting the headspace, but not so much because the headspace is on this belt. So you can mix, you can definitely do some adjustment here and tighten it up in the chamber, but where the headspace measurement is here, and you have no control over in the die what's going on in this section here. You know, when you have a rimmed cartridge, it's a little bit of the same. Because this die is actually going to be typically a straight-walled die, and so all you're doing is squeezing the outside. So there's really no adjustment. And then same with pistol loads. It's the same story that you there's nothing that you're going to do. The only thing that you can really do with pistol loads, because it headspaces on the lip right here, is that you can adjust your trim length. And that's more of an advanced technique that we're not probably going to cover here. So really what you've got to do, and I do the bump sizing on my rifle dies, I do bump sizing on standard rifle dies, but really, I don't do it for my hunting loads, only for, you know, more loads that are focused on accuracy, because I just don't want to be in a situation where I got to cycle the bolt fast and I have any kind of hang up. So really this is a focus on accuracy, but what it's going to do is it's going to reduce the amount that this stretches and forward and towards the rear. Now what's going to happen is if you overdo this, you're going to actually, well, let me rephrase. What's going to happen if you don't check your headspace and don't adjust is that you could actually, when you're expanding and contracting, you know, so you shoot it and it expands and then you resize it and it contracts, you could actually end up with case breaks and you'll get a crack right in the neck area just like that, or you can get a split in the head just like this. And that's all from expanding and contracting. These are very, very dangerous. The neck, split necks, not so much. But the case head crack, or case head separation, as this is called, can be very dangerous, because this is going to, if you think about it, create a very, very small opening for flame to shoot back into your face. It can travel down the bolt, it can go down the firing pin hole, it can shoot out the side of the gun. This is extremely dangerous. So we're going to talk about brass inspection in I think the next video, but just this is the part of the reason why it's good to stay on top of what your headspace is, know what that dimension is, don't oversize your brass if you can avoid it, because you're going to get longer case life and then you're going to avoid issues with split necks or case head separation. So hopefully that makes sense. That's what headspace is. Again, it is the distance between the bolt face closed and locked to the area that stops forward movement on the case. So, and you can see that it's pretty obvious this stops forward movement here on a rimmed cartridge. This stops forward movement again on a pistol cartridge. Forward movement is stopped on the lip. So one thing you want to do for pistol is, part of the reason why we trim is to have very consistent headspace. And then on non-belted, which is what most of us are using, is that it's on the datum line on the shoulder, right in this area here. So hopefully that makes sense to you guys. That's Headspace 101, but it is important that you know what it does, how it affects your rifle, how you can maximize accuracy and brass life by controlling it. And when to control it and when not to. So this is Paul with Reloading 123. Let me know if you have any questions, and I'm gonna go begin enjoying my vacation in Cancun, Mexico. Hopefully you enjoyed this. Take care, thanks.